Hello, you are listening to the Celebrity Speakers Podcast, produced by the National Arts Centre English Theatre and coming to you from the studio of Canada's National Arts Centre in Ottawa. I'm Sean Fitzpatrick. Welcome to the fourth and final podcast of the 2008-2009 Celebrity Speaker Series with host Laurie Brown. In this season series, Laurie, nationally respected arts journalist and host of CBC Radio's The Signal, speaks with some of the foremost artists in the country. In this interview, Laurie Brown speaks with Graham Greene, Academy Award-nominated actor of stage and screen. For more information about the NAC English Theatre, please visit www.nac-cna.ca. And now, here are Laurie Brown and Graham Greene.
There was a reason I really wanted to speak to Graham Greene, and then that was just a little indication about it, is that whatever he's done in his career, I've always had the feeling that there's something else he could be doing at the same time, and that acting is what he's doing, and it's almost like, I don't know, that this career may have been a gigantic happy accident for you.
It could, because I always said I was going to clean up in Ottawa.
And tell me about your history here at the NAC.
Well, it all started in a small little studio. We came up here to do a little play called Dry Lips Out of Move to Kapuskasing back in 91, 92. And it was horrible because I'd just been nominated for an Oscar.
That's horrible?
Well, when you get to the rehearsal hall and there's four camera crews down there, they're all barging, trying to get in and film the rehearsal. And somebody's changing the marquee, Dry Lips Out of Move to Kapuskasing, starring Oscar nominee Graham Greene. I made them take that down. It's an ensemble play, you know. It's not just one person in it, so.
Well, what was that like? Here you were coming to the NAC to do this play, and all of a sudden this incredible barrage. What did you think about that nomination?
Well, I was standing in the living room watching the news, and of course, and they announced the Academy nominees, and I just about spilled my coffee. They went ring, and I couldn't say anything for a minute or two. And my wife came out of the bedroom, and I said, "I just been nominated for an Oscar." She says, "Yeah, sure. Get your coat. We got to get to work." And we got here, and all this hoopla was going on. So it was trying and stressful, but the one thing I did concentrate on was the performance in the play itself. And hope it did a good job.
What did you think about that play? Tell me about that play.
I thought it was weird at first when I first read it, because we workshopped it in Montreal. Then I put it out of my mind completely, and then I found out they were doing it at Passe-Marie, Theatre Passe-Marie in Toronto, and they called me up and said, "Well, do you want to do it?" And I said, "Sure." I was out of work, sick of waiting tables, driving cabs, so I took the job. And we did the show there. Went to the National Arts Center in Winnipeg. Then we went to the Mauritius Theatre, the Royal Alex.
Getting that nomination, that was like, you hadn't done too many films at that point, had you, when Dances with Wolves came out?
Well, you could put my film resume on a piece of toilet paper. That's about how many films I had. It took me 4 months to learn dialect, and we shot for about 5 months and just walked away.
So.
Thought nothing of it.
How did you get the part? What was the audition process like?
We went in. the late Elizabeth Lustig, who was the casting director for Tig Productions at that time, met with a bunch of us in while we were doing Dry Lips Out and moved to Kapuskasing. So she had like the cream of the crop of native young native actors there. She went back, talked to Kevin about it, and he said, "I didn't look native enough." And then the head designer and Elizabeth worked on him. They took my face and sketched the costume around it, did all kinds of stuff, and bugged him until he finally said, that, "Well, have him come down, we'll meet." So we met and read some of the scenes in English, because I didn't know Lakota from anything. And finally just turned to me when he was walking out of the office and said, "Don't cut your hair." And that was, they say, is that.
Now, I'd read that you were actually selling T-shirts on the street when you got the part.
Shh. My accountant will find out about that. I was making my own T-shirts, printing them with Leno Block printing, and selling them on Queen Street. And as soon as I sold one shirt, there was lunch money. Mm-hmm. It was a hot dog and a beer. And I didn't make any money at it. I think I sold, in 2 or 3 weeks, sold about 8 shirts. The rest I just gave away.
Acting wasn't something that you had a passion for right at the beginning. You decided, in high school you were going to be an actor. What were you thinking in high school?
I wasn't. It was the 60s. Don't even ask me the name of the school. No, I never really considered it. I wanted to be a draftsman. And after I got out of high school, grade 9, of course, was the happiest 4 years of my life. Then I decided to move on. I was a carpet layer, a carpenter, a high steel worker, a welder, construction, labor, everything. I even was a draftsman. They found out I didn't like it.
Huh.
So I didn't do anything for a while, and consequently got involved in the music business. And a friend of mine, Kelly J. from Crowbar Days, I don't know if anybody knows,
yes,
Crowbar. We opened a little 4-track studio in Ancaster, and to work there, I worked with various bands and did sound for a number of years, lighting.
Did you like that lifestyle? Did you like being on the road with bands?
Yeah, it was fun when you're young.
Mm-hmm.
But then you find out you have no permanent address. Just like, "Where do you live? What's your address?" It's that big blue pickup truck, or the big blue truck over there.
Yeah.
And a friend, there was always a lot of people hanging around the studio, coming and going, musicians, actors, artists, you name it. And one day this guy came in and he said, "You know, you'd look great in this part of the script that I have." And I said, "What?" And he says, "The script." I says, "I've never seen a script before. What's it look like?" So he put it down and he says, "Read it. Just read it. I'll leave it with you." So this was on a Monday. Tuesday he came over. And I said, "I read it." He says, "What do you think?" I said, "I don't know. I didn't get it." "Well, read it again." Wednesday he comes over. "So what do you think now?" And I said, I don't know anything about this. I don't really want to be an actor. Friday he came over. I said, "No, definitely not. Definitely not." So Saturday, I see his car coming up the driveway. And I turn out the lights. He came up to the door and he says, "I know you're in there. I can hear you breathing." So I opened the door and I said, "What? I don't want to be an actor. I don't know anything about it. I don't have the training. I don't know anything about film." And he said, just go do it. I said, "I'll tell you what." I pulled out a deck of cards and put it on the console. And I said, "Well, cut cards. If I win, leave me alone. And if you win, I'll do it." So he cut first. I forget what he picked out, but I pulled up the two of spades. And that next week I was working and I found out, this is great. It's like the life of a dog. They tell you to speak, you speak. You know, they bring you food, water. And when they don't need you for that right then, they'll put you back in your kennel, which we call the dressing room. And they dress you nice.
What did you think about the first night when there was an audience in front of you?
I think I did my first play. It was called The Crack Walker, I believe it was.
That was Judith Thompson, right?
Yeah, Judith Thompson, yeah. Crack Walker. And I had to come busting in from an alley on the side of the building, which came onto the stage. And I guess that was my first time in front of an audience, and I just stood there and looked at them. And I was supposed to be beat up and bruised and stuff. And one night, I was standing out in the alley. I see these lights coming by. So I backed up. It's in a little alcove, just big enough for the door to fit in. And I'm standing behind, standing inside it by the door, waiting for my entrance, which I hear is coming any second. This car starts to go by very slowly, and it's got a big blue stripe down the side with the Metro Toronto Police Department written on it. It went past, and the brake lights lit up. It backed up, and I'm standing in there, and the flashlight's shining on me. And I'm all cut up, and clothes ripped, and filthy. The guy says, what are you doing? And I says, I'm working in this theater here. He said, sure you are, and I'm the mayor, or something. But anyway, I made my cue to bust in the door. I went flying, and they came chasing me on stage. And I just keep on working. I was performing, and they're standing there, just totally gobstruck. Not knowing what was going on here. So that's when I fell in love with theater. That was, my God, that was theater, all right. You couldn't pay for that, you know.
Now, soon after that, at the beginning of your career, you went to England to do stage work. How did that happen? What was behind that?
Paul Thompson, who was a freelance director at the time, he was working in and around Passmurai, and asked me if I wanted to go and do a collective work in Britain. I said, what the hell's a collective work? But I heard Britain, all right. I heard that clear as a bell.
Yeah.
So I packed my stuff and flew over there. And it was just an improv stuff every day. And I was getting better at it, but not as good as I wanted to be. And the first day we got there, I went over to a friend's place and stayed overnight. He had taken his car and got it to the garage, got the oil changed, got it serviced, got the thing all topped up, and had new tires put on it and everything. And I said, geez, what's going on? He said, well, we're going up to Rotherham, aren't we? I said, how far is it? He said, about 2 hours. I said, Howard, Christ, I drive that far to go to work every morning, you know? So I was totally baffled. And so I got in, not being used to the English transportation system, I put my head back and fell asleep. And Howard did something very abrupt with the car. I don't know, he swerved out of there or something. I woke up and looked, and there was no steering wheel in front of me. I panicked. And there was no pedals or brakes. I thought, this is a flipping nightmare. But I calmed down, got used to it, and the work was fun. We just did the... We carried our own sets. We toured these working man's clubs and any place that was big enough to set up a bunch of chairs in. And we did this show, and we brought it back to England and played it for a week at Passmurai, and everybody liked it. It was okay.
Wow. That whole collective experience and that time, particularly in theater in Toronto, was a real rich one.
Mm-hmm.
You must have felt it. Did you feel it at the time that there was something special going on?
No, because I never went to theater.
Mm.
It's like working at the Ford plant. I wouldn't hang around there on the weekends, you know.
Okay, you made a decision. Made a decision that, okay, acting seems to be what's going on. What kind of a life did you expect you were going to have as an actor in Canada?
I have no idea. All I knew is that I didn't have to carry amplifiers or anymore or drive a truck. And it was something that I really didn't say that, okay, I'm quitting life in general and going to be an actor, because I know from firsthand that actors do not work all the time. And some of them shouldn't.
So what did you do when you weren't acting?
Oh, I pulled up my skills from what I learned growing up. And it's just get a carpentry job here, do a little stuff here, do a little lighting, do a little welding. Whatever I can get my hands on.
And then how did the move happen for you from stage to film? Was it as simple as getting an agent and saying, okay, you're going out for some parts here?
Funny you should ask. Because I went to several agents, and none of them wanted to represent me. Then I was working as an executive director for an arts organization in Toronto. And part of it was in the arts and things like that. And we had a whole library of native actors who wanted to be actors, who weren't really actors, who shouldn't be actors. And I got a call from this company in Goldfinch Productions in England. And they were looking for native actors. So some of them couldn't afford to go to New York to meet Hugh Hudson, the director. So myself and three other guys went down, because we had the cash. And my friend's agent, who I talked to try to get represented by, she answers the phone. It's Hugh Hudson, the director, on the other end. She says, I don't really much like your client, but the other guy with the long hair, do you represent him? She says, oh yeah. Liar.
Why didn't she want to represent you? Did she?
I don't know. Just there's no market for native actors at that time.
And really, what was your sense about the parts that were available for you, either in stage or in film? What were you? What did you think?
Dress up and say "ugh" and "howl" for peanuts? I don't think so. I didn't want to do those roles.
But you must have been sent or being asked to go in a lot of those auditions at that time.
I'd read the script, and some scripts I just tear out pages with my name on it. Mm-hmm. And that's not a good thing to do, because you miss pages, and it says, okay, this is where you fall off a cliff. It's in the middle of winter, and you only have your underwear on. You don't find out these things till after you sign the contract. So you find yourself doing all kinds of stuff. So consequently, I do read the entire scripts now. Instead of just taking out pages with, okay, bullshit, bullshit, my line, bullshit, bullshit, my line.
And now that you're reading all the script, what is it that you look for in a script?
Okay. Do I have to fall down? Do I have to ride anything? Do I have to ride anything with legs? Where is it? Is it warm? Just things like that. No, if a script's got integrity and it tells a good story, then I'm interested in it.
Yeah. Because I think if you ask most actors in this country, that question, they'll just say, if I'm going to get paid, I'm going to do it.
Yeah, that's the other thing people will always say. What, Mr. Greene, what got you into the role of this character in this particular project? I have a mortgage. That's it. I have a mortgage. It's just another job.
When you were, you know, from your entrance into Theater Pas Mirai and looking out in an audience and making the switch to film, how did you make that switch? What was it in that you figured out that you had to do differently for film than you were doing on, in theater?
Act smaller.
Really small, eh?
Yeah. In film, you basically don't do anything. That's why I like it. Well, it's true. I mean, you see a 40-foot screen with a big pumpkin head on the middle of it. The guy's not doing anything. He's just, his lips are moving, you know. So that's what you do.
Do you see the films that you're in? Do you go and see them?
A lot of them are Canadian, so I haven't seen them. I doubt if anybody has. I haven't got one copy of one Canadian film that I did. And I've never seen... Augie Schellenberg's in the house tonight. He's doing XC of Rita Jo. Mm-hmm. We both did a film called Running Brave back in the late... mid-80s, I guess. Or early 80s. And we were having dinner tonight, and he said, "Have you seen Running Brave?" And I said, "No." And he says, "Neither have I."
That's unbelievable.
Yeah.
And you think that's still the case now? I mean, you still feel the same way? Because you've been involved in the industry at a time of exponential growth, actually.
Yeah. It was, I don't know, I asked Norman Jewison, I said, "Why is there no film industry in Canada, per se?" And he says, "My boy, I can't tell you that. I don't know. There are people running around, they do films, but you never see their companies again. And consequently, there's no distribution, no sales. I don't know what they do. I guess they're running out of dentists to back films in Canada now." Well, that's what they used to do.
Yeah, it was dentists and doctors looking for tax write-offs that really got things going.
The industry has been good to me over the past, I don't know how many years I've been doing this now, 35 or 34 years. And it's had its ups and downs. I mean, last year was a bad year for everybody because of the negotiations with the Screen Actors Guild and the producers about signing a deal. It had one little thing that some people in Screen Actors Guild wanted and some people didn't. So they're fighting back and forth and fighting back and forth. So very few films were made down there. Now, a lot of them are being made in Vancouver under the British Columbia Film Agreement, and they're coming up from the States. And everybody's just getting sick of it because all the work's going away. My agency, my agent down in L.A., I was talking to him, and he said he sent out, on an average year, maybe 60 people to go audition for pilots and things like that. This year, he sent out six. Because there was just nothing. Nobody wanted to put up the money to have a film that was going to be go on strike. And they couldn't get the contracts with Screen Actors Guild anyway. So a lot of them just did not produce anything or even television. That's why we have so many GD reality shows. God, I hate those. Who wants to see somebody suffering? You know, and no, they're just... These people are not pretending, or maybe they are. It's like Saturday afternoon wrestling, you know.
Exactly. So I know that you have a lot of passions that you have outside of acting. So when you've got a slow year or things are calmed down.
A slow decade.
A slow decade?
Yeah.
What do you like to do?
I build boats. 3/4-inch cedar strip boats. I built one, it was sitting in my yard, and I had a yard sale, and everybody was coming over, and it wasn't just junk and broken teapots and stuff, it was like good tools and things that I just wanted to get rid of. And Bill Lishman from Father Goose fame, he came over, and he said, "How much you want for the boat?" I said, "How much you got?" He said, "I got $500 in my pockets." I sold, take it away. That one, and the next one was a 19 and a half foot rowing shell I built for a friend of ours up there because she was complaining that she didn't have the money to buy a rowing shell and it was her passion. And I said, oh, don't worry about it, Karen, I'll build you one. This is what happens after the third glass of wine. And you find yourself standing in the garage going, what the hell have I gotten myself into? I had never even seen a rowing shell. I couldn't get plans anywhere. I had to basically educate myself how to build one. And that took about 6 months.
Yeah, but when we talked on the phone the other day, you were telling me about the next project you were thinking of making.
Oh, yeah, a bike, a chopper. Maybe. My wife doesn't know about this.
Whoops,
but
sorry.
But I'm sure she's going to find out real damn fast. And I'm going to find out that I won't be building it.
Do you love motorcycles?
Oh, yeah, I do.
Yeah.
I do. I can't have one. My first wife, she said to me, it's either me or that damn Harley. And I sat there at the table for a while, and she said, well, as I'm thinking. And the second time I was in South Dakota shooting Dances with Wolves, and my not then wife, Hillary, was on the other end, and I said, I got a really good deal on this stretched out apple cherry red Harley with lots of chrome on. It's a beautiful machine. It's your money. Which in women talk means no. So I didn't get it. Oh, I would have got it from her.
And what about food?
Food, I love food. I had a $50,000 renovation done to my kitchen. I got a big six burner wool stove, a General Electric monogram fridge, one of them big huge suckers that looks like a tank with no tracks on it. A beautiful maple block island, and French cookware, all the best knives you can possibly get. I got it all finished, ready for Thanksgiving, and my wife's mother decided she wanted to have Thanksgiving at her house. Fine.
But you love to cook?
Yeah, I do. I do the majority of the cooking at home.
Yeah.
Once in a while, I let her in the kitchen.
Uh-huh.
Because she doesn't use the knives properly. So I try to cut a roast with a paring knife. Perfectly good carving knife sitting right there. Now, my wife's a really good cook, too.
And then I'm thinking about when you went back to, you went to Stratford. You didn't go back to Stratford, you went to Stratford.
I went to Stratford, yeah.
To do The Merchant of Venice.
Mm-hmm. And Of Mice and Men.
Yeah. Now, I'm thinking about, you've never been to Stratford before and you'd never have any formal training. That would scare the hell out of me if I was asked to do that.
Well, it had been 16 years since I was on in front of a live audience on stage. And one night, we were sitting in Toronto, my wife and I, having dinner. And in walks the late, great Richard Monette, who was the artistic director at the time, and he sat down at the table next to us, and he tried to get me to go to Stratford in 84, and I says, you crazy, Stratford? I can't talk like, hey, dee thou, dee da der thou, them. It's not in my nature to talk funny. But I said to Richard, we were outside having a smoke, when I smoked, I don't smoke anymore, I quit 5 months ago. I said, Richard, do you think it would be a good thing if I came to Stratford for your last year? Oh, would it? He said. That would be lovely. And he's like a bull terrier when he gets your pant leg. You don't let go. And he had people phoning me from the festival and having meetings downtown with people who would sit me across from the table like the SS and say, do you know how to deal with the press? Do you know how to deal with questions from reporters who ask like four questions in one? I said to him, I've been doing this for 30 years. No, but do you know how to answer a reporter? So I said, I let him go, and he just got all this 3D the way they do things at Stratford is the way you had to as an actor. Then I got the two books, and I kept thinking, I can't do this. I cannot do this.
What was it that was really stopping you?
How to handle the text in Shakespeare. I call it the diuretic banter, but it's iambic pentameter. And I thought, if I couldn't get that right, how the hell am I going to learn Shakespeare? But I found out that once I got that, Mice and Men was much harder to learn.
Really?
Yeah.
Why?
Because Lenny says George over 73 times in the play, but I couldn't exactly place where he said George. George, where are we going? Where are we going, George? Where are we, George, going? It was a difficult play. But Merchant of Venice, I was only in 5 scenes, which is perfect.
Yeah, but they're killer scenes.
No, they're not. Not anymore. But I just forced myself into it and just went and did all the right things at Stratford. I call it the actor's hospital. Because when you go there, there's voice coaches, movement coaches, fighting instructors, text coaches. There's everything you can actually want as a serious actor. And you don't have to pay for it. They're paying you.
Well, that was probably the first time you'd ever really had that kind of access to that kind of help, wasn't it?
Yes, it does. I was never formally trained. I never took lessons from anybody. I just watched some of the best actors work. Mm. And that's the way I picked my stuff up. But when Richard said to me, you'll be there for 9 months. I said, 9 months? For Christ's sake, I could have a baby. Yeah. But it was long 9 months. But it got so that you get confused. Like, I was doing Mice and Men at the Tom Patterson Theater, and Merchant at the Festival Theater, and some nights I'd show up at the wrong theater and wonder why these other people were there.
That sounds like an actor's nightmare, like a bad dream.
And where am I supposed to be? Oh, right, over there. One night I was dithering around out in the loading dock, talking to the stage door guy. And they announce over the tannoy speaker, they tell you what's coming up. And I was finished. I was gone in the play. The courtroom scene's over. I don't care. So I'm standing out there, and I hear, curtain call. Curtain call. Ah, jeez. So I went running back in there, and I had what they call a cover-up on. It's a robe, so you don't burn your clothes. I suppose we're actors, after all. So I just had that on, and I'm running through backstage, peeling it off. I just heaved it over in the corner and made it just in time to go out on stage to take a bow. But I never went out again. I did that once in Montreal at the Centaur Theater. I was standing up in the lighting booth doing a Rubik's Cube with the lighting guy. And I was watching the play. I thought, geez, this is pretty good from up here. Those guys are all right. Oh, this is where I make my entrance. I never had to move so damn fast. I had to go down a flight of stairs, through the lobby, down another flight of stairs, through the entire length of the shop, and come up to the back of the stage where there was a set of doors that I was to bust in. And I just made it.
Oh, man.
I threw that Rubik's Cube away.
Bad news. Yeah. I had read that when you took on the roles at Stratford, you said that you needed a challenge in your life at that time to prove something to yourself about what kind of actor you were.
I did. I did want to do it. So after 30-some years, you start to doubt yourself. Was I capable of being on the same stage as so many great actors from around the world had been on. And am I capable of actually telling those two stories? And I found out I was. So I felt a whole lot better about myself as an actor, that I can do it. There's no small actors. There's no small parts, only small actors, you know. And I'm working on a project in Vancouver where I'm in six different scenes with only one line in each scene. And each line consists of no more than 10 words. I love it. I love it.
But it's still an acting job, for sure.
Yeah. But they're paying me.
That sense of not losing your confidence about being an actor, does film do that to an actor, working a long time in film, and that sense of going back on the stage? Does film make you a smaller actor? Like you said, everything you do has to be a lot smaller.
No, I think once you've been on a stage, you know what translates into what somebody can see in the back row. And that's something you don't ever lose. But a lot of these kids who start out in film, some of them just simply cannot work on a stage. They don't have the pipes. They just don't have the pipes to do it. And they have no idea how to work a stage.
Yeah, the one thing I've noticed in watching film actors on stage is that everything is happening on their face, and their bodies are just like sticks. They're not acting with their bodies. They're acting just here, and that's it.
Well, that's what they're used to. That's what they do. That's what they're trained to do. Because if you get your face 40 feet high and you're doing this, you're going to make somebody throw up. You know? It's like watching an episode of Traitors when that was on.
Oh, right.
Some kind of stomach medicine to calm down my stomach.
Gravel.
I'd take Gravel to watch the rest of it. Because the camera was doing all the jerking around, and it was just so hard to watch. It couldn't follow the story. But that once again, is the difference between certain genres of the way a camera will work. Because on stage, you're the camera. All of you are witnessing the story that's being told down here on stage. And it's much easier to deal with.
How does that lens differ from film to television? Are there subtle differences in what you need to do between making a film and doing a TV show?
Television show is basically just talking heads. That's all you see, there, like this. But film, you got scenery, you got all kinds of stuff to do. It's kind of wasted on television because it's so small. If you look at a movie on your TV, it's kind of uninteresting. But if you watch a television show, it's right there, your face.
How would you describe working on television? What's it like for you?
It's faster. Film takes a lot of time to set up. Television, you have to set up really quickly and get it done because you only got so many days to shoot it. An hour episode, you got five or six days. A film, you get as much time as you need. And there's an old adage in the industry about you shoot film in the morning and television in the afternoon. Because everybody takes so much time to do stuff in the morning, but at the end of the day, they have to have what they're told to get. When a film, if you miss a couple scenes, well, I'll come back and get them later. You know, you got to really think on your feet when you're doing television. And the best training place for that is on stage, where you get to perfect what you know you can do, what you're capable of. But if you get thrown right into television right away, you're either sink or swim.
Well, then why was it that there was 16 years when you didn't do any theater?
I didn't want to do theater anymore.
How come?
If you don't watch it, the boredom bug in theater will bite you right hard in the behind. And you get bored with it, then there's no point in doing it anymore. If you're not having fun, it's not a joy for you. I just didn't want to do it because it was no fun for me anymore. And film was fun because it was get to go to great places and travel a lot and stuff like that. Instead of getting on your bike and riding down to the street corner and walking into the theater. You know, it was just a lifestyle change.
So how do you describe Hollywood to your friends? I mean, I look at Hollywood and I think that there's things that are absolutely absurd about it. So being on the inside of that, how would you describe it?
It's like a little kid getting the biggest present under the tree and finding out it's something to wear.
So it's perpetually disappointing.
Yes, it is. It is highly disappointing. It's A, you can't get around unless you got a car. And B, everybody's, you know, nobody sees one another in the industry. I very rarely see anybody from the industry in Los Angeles. I have maybe two friends that are over all the years that I still keep in touch with, and they're not actors.
Did you ever think about moving there, or was that something you wanted to avoid at all costs?
You couldn't pay me enough to move there. Miserable. I wouldn't live down there ever. As my LA agent said, well, why don't you move down here? There's more work. And I said, the airport's only an hour away here. 4-hour flight, I can be there in 6 hours, you know, blah, blah. So what is the point?
But when you're actually working and on set, is that the way you like to work?
When I get to the set, I stay on the set all day. I don't leave. If I got a scene that's being shot without me in it, I'll stay up there until the scene that I'm in needs to be shot. Because a lot of people, they get on the set, they just go into their trailer and stay there until they're ready. And then you don't get to see the thing function, the speed of the production, how things work. It just makes your life easier if you're part of that machine rather than just being thrown in every now and again. And I find it very exciting.
So you've watched a lot of other actors do their stuff in other scenes.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, tell us a story.
A story?
Okay, 4 or 5.
I was always nosy about what was going on set, so I bought a scanner. And I'd scan all the radios that the assistant directors had, and I'd listen to them. And if I heard my name, I'd leave my trailer and go and hide someplace. Or I'd make my way around to the set and stand behind the camera and wait for them to try and find me. You'd see one of them running around way down the street someplace, and I'd pick up a radio off one of the crew guys and tune it in and say, I feel like it's Mr. Greene. I think he just went to that little candy store in the corner. And we'd all watch. Another time I was shooting a Canadian film up in Alberta, which I never seen. And they had, it was really, really low budget, and they had three different sets of radios because all the communication companies were had rented them all up because there was a lot of filming going on. And I had my scanner, and they had to relay a message down the hill. And the first part of the conversation was, the sound recording guys need some isopropyl alcohol to clean the heads. The second relay was, they needed some mineral oil to clean the heads. And the third message was, mineral oil, why can't they use mineral water? And nothing ever got done on that set. It was so confusing.
Did you learn from other actors watching them work?
I learned from great actors off watching a lot of movies and stuff.
Yeah? Who are the actors that you really appreciate?
Oh, I like watching Gene Hackman, Robert Duvall when he's in a good mood, Jack Lemmon.
You always hear that people saying that doing comedy is harder than doing anything else.
Yes, on film it is.
Why? What makes it so hard?
Because nobody can laugh. So you don't know if a gag worked or not. And the thing is, if you have a good stinger line and you have another line after that, you split it up so you get the laugh. The audience in the theaters laugh. Then you say the last part of the line, if it's funny. And that's a technique that a lot of actors, some of them don't know when to shut up, you know. They don't know when to take a pause. And that's basically stage is frightening like that, because you don't know what's going to happen night for night, night by night. Some nights the audience is with you and they're just laughing it up, eating up the story. And other nights you can hear, what did he say? What? What's that on his head? But it's like walking through a minefield on stage for an actor. A minefield of words that you trip on one, you set the whole dang thing off angle, and you lost them, you know.
And when you're doing comedy on film, do you leave holes for where you are hoping the audience is going to be laughing?
Well, in rehearsal, you can pretty much judge, but when you're shooting, you can't. In rehearsal, the crew will laugh. If it's funny, they'll laugh, so you know where to put that pause.
And I think you'd also have to have a pretty good sense of confidence to get you through the film if it's comedy, because I'd be going home on the second night of shooting going, on, that's not funny, nothing's funny, I'm not funny, nobody's laughing.
But I'm getting paid. Now that's funny.
I'm sensing a recurring theme here with your career, Graham.
What? Getting paid for Canadian movies I've never seen. It's like taking money for nothing, you know. But no, seriously, I like doing this. It's probably the longest career I've had in my life. It's fun sometimes.
When's it not fun?
Oh, when it's a perfectly good dry day and it calls for rain in the script. And they put up rain towers and soak you down. And if it's cold, it's more fun. And there's other things, the traveling. And living in hotels is getting pretty boring now. I mean, if I go someplace and get an efficiency hotel with a kitchen, I'm happy.
Have there been parts? I know you talked about physical hardships, but have there been parts and have there been roles that have given you trouble?
If they were to give me trouble, I wouldn't take them.
So you know beforehand? You've never taken something and then
regretted it?
Yeah.
I shouldn't say that I have, but that's just they said, what are you doing here? Paying the rent. I'm just paying the mortgage. That's all I'm doing. You know? But still, you give a performance that's worthy of the story or worthy of your fellow actors and like that, it's, you know, you can't be happy doing everything.
What are you proud of? What are the roles that you're proud of?
Well, I don't know. There's one called Clear Cut. Mm-hmm. It was a Canadian film. I saw it. It was good. That role was very challenging. We basically rewrote a lot of the stuff, a lot of the scenes.
Tell me about your role in that.
Well, there's Ron Lee, Canadian actor, Michael Hogan, and myself on this sort of an odyssey. I had captured Michael Hogan and tied him up and took him on this river odyssey with Ron Lee's character, who was a lawyer fighting a logging claim. Mm-hmm. And it was hard work, but it was a lot of fun to go to work every day. We'd be shooting a scene, a really tough scene, and I didn't see this, but everybody else did. A fishing lure went flying behind me into the lake, and the director yelled, cut. Who was that? And almost the whole crew went. It was Michael Hogan. He brought his fishing rod with him, and his truck, and his boat, had a little camp table and a Coleman lamp. He'd make his own dinner, and he'd catch a fresh trout and cook it up, and he'd sit there on the beach at night having his dinner.
That role, what was it about what you were playing that made you proud about what you were doing?
It was just, I don't know if I was proud of it, but it was a very, very powerful role indeed. And I enjoyed working. I haven't worked with Michael in film, and he's a good friend of mine, so we had a chance to go and play around up north for a couple of weeks. It was great.
You've had a lot of very powerful roles in film. Mm-hmm. That must be nice.
Well, I don't know if it's nice or not, but it's certainly fun doing them.
How would you describe your relationship with directors?
Shaky. No, not really. I mean, a lot of directors I like to work with. They don't give me too much trouble. What do you want me to do? Act. No, you're the director. What do you want here? Tell me specifically what you want. You know. And if they tell me what they want, I'll just say, no, I'm doing it like this. And then I'll do it the way you want it, okay? You know, there's those choices in film. You can do as many takes as you want. I usually do three. It's one for me, one for the director, and one for the camera.
And which one do you see making it to the screen?
Mine. Usually, because sometimes if you're shooting out of context, which you always do, you might shoot the end of the picture, then come back and do the first part of it, and so on and so on. If you don't follow the story through and have it in your head constantly, it's almost impossible to continue that story. If you're shooting out of sequence, it's very hard. Where the arc of the story is, where the climax should be, and how much power you want to put into that character, mm-hmm. into that speech. It has to be there.
How much do you feed off of other actors around you?
Oh, a lot. I went over to Augie's place for dinner.
I should have known better.
I had lunch.
Wrong choice of words.
I had lunch with Michael Hogan. And I usually go over to their place a lot around dinner time.
Let me rephrase this, Graham.
Oh.
See? Do you find that you collaborate?
See, you're directing.
Do you find that you collaborate, you like collaborating with other actors? That there's something that they feed? There's something that they give you on screen?
Yeah, check.
Okay, let me try this again. Do you think that... do you enjoy working with other actors?
No.
Why?
Only the good ones.
And who are the good ones?
The ones I work with.
I give up.
All right. No.
What do you think it takes to be an actor? I mean, if you were going to say, okay, these are the qualities that you need to have to be an actor, what would they be?
Well, I tell all young kids, first get your cab license, learn how to wait tables, and learn how to bartend. You'll always have a job. But, it's, you know, I work with young kids, I work as a professional. Punctual, on time, have your work memorized, have your lines down before you even go to the set, because it just it doesn't help anybody to watch an actor dither around reading his pages without trying to set up some kind of rapport with the other actors. It just doesn't work for me. So I'm always adamant that young kids do. Have your work done before you come in the next day, if you're working with me. If you're not, I don't care what you do.
But that idea of having your, you know, being a bartender and being able to drive a cab makes me think that also part of your approach to this whole career is not to have any great expectations about what kind of work should be coming to you or what you should be doing.
No, I don't have any expectations about what's coming down the line for me.
Yeah.
It's there. The only work you turn down in my industry is the job that's offered to you.
Right.
Because I've not done some scripts, I've not done some films because I didn't like them. I didn't like the integrity, I didn't like the story it told, I didn't like how it went. What were the characters, the people I didn't like. And now that I see them, I'm sorry I did. some of them turned out better than I thought. You know?
But if going to Stratford was one of those decisions that felt like, you know, I really need this challenge at this point in my life, is there something else like that in the back of your head that you're waiting for an opportunity to do?
Yeah, 80.
The number, the age?
Well, I can't wait to get to 65 so I can retire. Because when you're an actor, you're always semi-retired.
Mm-hmm.
But then, when I do retire, I can still act and draw a pension. I don't know why they don't do that now. What?
I'm just trying to absorb that.
Well, you know, you could still act under the Screen Actors Guild if you're drawing a pension.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you just plan to keep on trucking?
Yep. As long as there's films to be made, I'll be there to try and make them. It's what I love best now, like next to my wife, of course. Once you get into it, it's very hard to not be an actor. I know some of the great actors that I know and used to hang around with, they'll never get to film, but they're great, damn good stage actors.
Mm-hmm.
And they love the stage. And you got to love the stage to stay there and not let it bore you, because that's what happened to me. And just after 16 years, I decided I wanted to go back.
I can't imagine, well, I can't imagine being on stage, but having to be in front of a live audience every night, I would think for me would be, it would be hard to find that boring.
Not so sometimes. Like one night in Stratford, I came out in my first particular segment. And there was a man sitting in the front row with one shoe and one sock off, picking his toe and flicking something. I don't know what it was, but I didn't let it distract me. And then one night, I looked up, and there was a whole row of little blue faces. All these kids were up there texting one another, back and forth. Then the other night, there was a couple sitting over on this particular side of the stage, making out like they were at home. And it was distracting and annoying. Because all I could see was the back of everybody's heads over on this side.
You're watching them.
Yeah. Yeah, it's funny.
There have been many opportunities, and I know that many times people have wanted and expected you to be a spokesperson for all kinds of Native issues.
Yes, they tend to think that, but I'm not political. I leave that to the politicians. If I want to be a spokesman, I want to be a spokesman for myself. Because all these causes and issues, I don't know anything about them. I had an interview in Los Angeles right after Thunderheart came out. And she kept asking me, what do you think of the whole thing during Wounded Knee? And I said, I don't know, I wasn't there. And she kept saying things like, well, the whole incident at Wounded Knee was like pretty drastic for what happened. And I said, I couldn't tell you, I wasn't there. And if I wasn't there, how the hell am I going to know about it? You know, from some newsreel footage? That's biased. So I can't be a spokesperson for everybody.
Well, even if you say you're not, I still think that with your career and what you've done with your career, you've kicked open the door, and I think, let a lot of other Native actors come in behind you and get some decent work. Do you get that sense?
I do have that sense. There's a lot more Native actors than I know of now than there used to be when I first started out. Practically none. But through my, when I was an executive director, like I said, our casting wing, we got a lot of opportunities for a lot of people and a lot of doors open for them. So I guess that's my legacy.
You feel pretty good about that one?
Well, if it helps people, helps young people get to work and follow their dream and be an actor and actually make a living at it, then fine, yeah. Mm-hmm. Except they're taking all my work now.
Get me Graham Greene. No, get me someone like Graham Greene.
Graham who?
Yeah, that's the final part of that joke.
Yeah.
In the parts that you see yourself being offered or to read for, how many of those are actually playing Native roles now, and how many of them are just playing anybody?
Percentage-wise, about 50-50 now, I guess. As I played a New York cop, I played lawyers, I've played the ghost of a black transvestite. No, I kid you not, in a show in Montreal. And I had to jump out of a window. It's just my underwear holding my high heels. It was invigorating.
At least you had the good sense to take off the heels before you jumped.
Yeah. I played an old Jewish guy in a play who never walked on stage. He never went on stage. He was too old to get up to the second floor of this furniture store where they were having a midnight madness sale. So I just talked over this little tannoy speaker. And a nice Jewish accent. Wesley, what are you doing up there now? Hey. And I was sitting backstage and I was working on a TV series called 9B at the time, shooting that in the day and doing this play at night. So I'd have my 9B script back there working on it and have the other script open, the microphone.
Oh dear.
Huh?
I can kind of guess what's going to come next.
Well, I finished the one little segment with Wesley up on the second floor. I closed my book, closed my scripts, put them in my bag, and went home. And the first thing staring me in the face was the kitchen clock. The play was not over yet. I had one more little scene to do with Wesley and his friend, the customer. And I thought, I'll never make it back to the theater now. So I poured a drink, watched a little TV, went to bed. Went back the next day, greeted everybody like nothing had happened. They were not talking to me. The stage manager locked the door so I could not get out, no matter what.
And you still have a career.
That's what I laughingly refer to as my career, no? Oh, some of those things that happen. That's a little things you won't change for, you know. It's not that you go around looking to do this stuff.
You must have had some fun working on the Red Greene show.
Oh, yeah. That was a hoot and a half. I had no idea how to approach that character. And the first time we shot it, I went into the dressing room. And there's one of the writers. He's got a pair of coveralls, and they're all ripped up and burnt. And had the safety vest on with explosives on the back and a hard hat. Ear protectors and a baseball cap. So I had no idea. I put the stuff on. I looked in the mirror and went, I'm Edgar T. Montrose. Edgar K.B. Montrose. The K.B. stands for Kaboom. And went out and pretend I couldn't hear what Patrick McKenna was saying right off the top. So he'd say stuff like, okay, what do you got for us today, Edgar? And I said, oh, that'll get better if you just keep putting the salve on it. And that got a laugh. Then. And we'd just have fun. It was like a big family playing together. And it was probably the only fun I'd have all year, other than being Mr. Crabtree on Dudley the Dragon.
I love that show.
Yeah. Don't say you watched it when you were a little girl either.
No, my children watched it.
Ah, okay. Yeah, but I'm responsible for getting a lot of little kids about 4 and 5 saying, "What the?" Because every time somebody would surprise the tree when he's sleeping, he'd always wake up and go, "What the?" But I'd never finish the sentence.
So I'm getting the sense that what really keeps you in the game is the fun of the moment and being there.
Yep. Yeah, it's just fun. I love doing comedy, and I love doing drama.
So, funny man? Is that really what you are at heart?
No, I like funny. It's just funny. I like anything funny.
Mm-hmm. Do you think Mel Gibson is a funny man?
When we did Maverick, yeah, we just practical joking all day long. And none of that stuff was in the written script. The stuff that we made up was all just, we just ad-libbed it out. And the writer was on set one day, and he was watching the monitor. And we finished a scene, and he said, "I think I heard one of my words." Yeah, he's funny. He's like I said, he likes pulling practical jokes all the time.
I'd like a song.
She's not looking at me.
Huh?
She wants a song.
A song?
Yeah.
Oh, a song. Oh, when I grow older, I shall grow bolder, then I will hold her close to my shoulder. And in our future life, she's gonna be my wife. How the hell did you find that out? She told me so.
Graham Greene.
Send us your comments and questions. You can reach us by sending an email to hinterviews@gmail.com. We look forward to hearing from you. Don't forget you can subscribe to this and other NAC podcasts by visiting www.nac-cna.ca/podcasts. There you'll find our past episodes, subscription links, and instructions on how to subscribe. You can easily find us as a free subscription in the podcast section of the iTunes Music Store. Search on Hinterviews. If you'd like to stay in touch with news and updates from the NAC English Theatre, sign up for a free e-bulletin by visiting www.nac-cna.ca/emailalerts. You can also find us on Facebook. Become a fan of the NAC English Theatre on Facebook by entering NAC English Theatre into the search bar. Until next time, this is Sean Fitzpatrick for Peter Hinton and Company saying goodbye from Canada's National Arts Centre in Ottawa.